الفاتحة. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، الرحمن الرحيم، مالك يوم الدين، إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين، اهدنا الصراط المستقيم، صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. صدق الله العظيم. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، بارئ الخلائق أجمعين، باعث الأنبياء والمرسلين، ثم الصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين، خاتم النبيين، شفيع المذنبين، حبيب الله العالمين، أبي القاسم المصطفى محمد. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد وعلى آل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين، ولعنة الله على أعدائهم أجمعين من يوم عداوتهم إلى يوم الدين. أما بعد، فقد قال الله عز وجل في كتابه الحكيم وهو أصدق القائلين، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم: يا أيها الذين آمنوا إن جاءكم فاسق بنبأ فتبينوا. آمنا بالله، صدق الله العلي العظيم. صلوات اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد. السلام عليكم جميعا ورحمة الله وبركاته. I begin in the name of Allah, the most kind, the most merciful. It's due to His kindness and mercy that we have these opportunities where we gather in remembrance and glorification of Him, Tabaraka wa Ta'ala. Next, we send our congratulatory messages to our 12th and living Imam Al-Hujjah and to each and every one of you as we gather this evening to celebrate the birth anniversary of our 10th Imam, the grandfather of our 12th Imam, Imam Ali al-Naqi, alayhima afdalu salatu wassalam. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. We pray to Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala that we each get an opportunity to go for the ziyarat of our Imam in Samarra very soon, insha'Allah, and that we receive his shafaat in the hereafter. Our 10th Imam alayhi salam was born on the 15th of Dhul Hijjah in the year 212 after Hijrah in Medina. And as we recall, his father, our ninth Imam alayhi salam, was martyred in the year 220 after Hijrah at the young age of 25. And so what that tells us is that at the young age of 8 years old, our 10th Imam began his role as the Imam of the Ummah and as the Imam and God's representative on this earth. That age is of course something that was difficult for the people to handle, but not as much as it was when his father, our ninth Imam alayhi salam, began his role as the Imamate at a very similar age. And so the brunt of the challenges associated with the young age of the Imam was felt by his father, the ninth Imam alayhi salam. And since this was the second time in a row this was happening, the challenges were slightly different in that sense, that it wasn't necessarily having to do with believing in his capabilities, because the ninth Imam had proven that at a young age he was capable of being the Imam of the Ummah. However, the age still was a hindering block. We can imagine that, you know, sometimes in our minds and in our hearts there are certain things which serve as roadblocks for us, and we find very difficult to cross them. For certain people, it could be the young age of someone. You know, for example, in our homes, we may not value the comments or the suggestions of someone young. We may not include them in conversations because we feel that they're young. And so there's a roadblock that we are created. Sometimes that roadblock has to do with gender, where we may not value the words of a specific gender. Or, for example, it could be race. Whatever it is, the Imam alayhi salam no doubt experienced that form of difficulty, but it was something that he was able to overcome and serve his role as the Imam of the Ummah. The date of his martyrdom was the 3rd of Rajab in the year 254 after Hijrah, which means his period of imamat was for 34 years, and he was martyred at the age of 42 through poisoning by Mu'taz, the son of Mutawakkil. What I want to do today is spend a little bit of time going over a few historical incidents from the Imam's life. You know, it's not something we do intentionally, because we recognize that they all 12 Imams are the Imams, and they all are Hujjatullah. They're all the proofs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yet the amount of knowledge we have about our Imams, especially those the latter Imams, is sometimes very limited, right? And it's important for us to be aware of some of the challenges that they went through, some anecdotes from their life to show how they responded to the challenges that they experienced. And so in today's lecture, that's what I want to do. I want to describe some portions of tests that the Imam was put through the hands of different people, just so that we can get a better grasp and understanding and appreciation for the life of our Imam. So I hope that you will benefit from this lecture as much as I benefited studying it. Sallu ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. Allahumma salli ala Muhammadin wa Ali Muhammad. So in the course of the Imam's life, especially the 34 years of imamat that he held, there were 6 different Abbasid caliphs who lived during that time. It starts from Mu'tasim, and then Wathiq, and then Mutawakkil, Muntasir, Musta'im, and then Mu'taz. If you look at the historical events surrounding the 9th, 10th, and the 11th Imams, this is when you begin to see that the army of the Muslim empire, I guess if we can call it, was heavily dominated by Turks. And these Turks had in many instances their own agendas. And so you find that in that period of the 9th, 10th and the 11th Imams, many Abbasid caliphs were assassinated by members of their own army because they did not toe the Turk line that the army leaders wanted them to follow. And so they were basically propping up these Abbasid caliphs to be in the position to carry out what they wanted. It's quite interesting how the dynamics worked of the empire at that time, or of the nation at that time. But when we look at the relationship between the caliphs and the imam, we find a little bit of a change. The first two caliphs that we talked about were Mu'tasim and Wathiq. Historians tell us they were more lenient with the imam. Now that leniency doesn't mean that they were friends with the imam or that they were compassionate with the imam. Rather, their role with the imam or their deception with the imam was manifested through a cloak of leniency, right? So they still wanted to know the whereabouts, to control the affairs of the imam, but yet they were a little bit more lenient. They weren't necessarily imprisoning the imam, torturing the imams as such. But this changed drastically when the third caliph, Mutawakkil, came. Mutawakkil is known in history, especially in his treatment of the Alawids and those who came from the progeny and of Amirul Mu'mineen Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salam, Allahumma salli ala Muhammadin wa ali Muhammad, to be the worst of all the Abbasid caliphs. He treated them and he carried out such massacres that none before him nor after him had carried out against the Alawids. Mutawakkil is famously known for paying people to have derogatory plays about Amirul Mu'mineen alayhi salam. He was the one who tried his best to flood the shrine of Aba Abdullah and then levy a huge tax on whoever wanted to go for the ziyarat of Aba Abdullah, and then even cutting off limbs of those who wanted to go for the ziyarat of Aba Abdullah alayhi salam. And it's really interesting that while all of this was happening, the 10th Imam alayhi salam always promoted going for the ziyarat of Aba Abdullah alayhi salam, to that extent, you know, where it is said that once he was ill and two of his companions came to see him, and he said to them, you know, that I hear that you are going for ziyarat. I want you to do me a favor, that when you get to the Qubba or under the dome of Aba Abdullah, I'd like you to pray for me. And so the companions agreed. And when they left, they asked each other, that, but he's the Imam, right? He can raise his hands to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and pray for whatever he wants, and God would grant him. So they came back, and when they came back, the Imam knew the question that they had, and he said, what you say is true, but there is certain merit to be under the dome of Aba Abdullah. So we pray to Allah that we all get an opportunity to go for the ziyarat of our Imam in Karbala very soon, and that this bala that we are going through comes to an end, inshallah. Sallu ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. And so Mutawakkil was known for his animosity, and the presence of the Imam in Medina while he was in Samarra and Baghdad and in these parts of Iraq today was an annoyance to him, especially as his military commander from Medina would write letters to Mutawakkil saying that the people are constantly going to the Imam, his popularity is increasing, and this is something that should be of concern to you. And so his plan was to try and exile the Imam from Medina and bring him to Samarra. But he had to do it in such a way where there would not be a significant blowback on him, because at the end of the day, they were politicians as well. And so there's a very interesting letter that he wrote to the Imam alayhi salam, wanting to quote unquote invite him to Samarra. And alhamdulillah, history gives us an opportunity to have this letter recorded. And so we get an opportunity to see the scheming of Mutawakkil. And so he writes this letter that I'd like to quote a passage of. He says, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, in the name of Allah, the most kind, the most merciful. Amma ba'ad, and after that, fa'inna amir al mu'mineen عارف بقدرك راع راع لقرابتك. He says, I, Amir al-Mu'mineen, am very well aware of your position. عارف بقدرك, and I am also have close regard and affinity for our kinship. موجب لحقك يقدر من الأمور فيك وفي أهل بيتك ما أصلح الله به حالك وحالهم. He's like, and I consider it a duty of mine to look after your affairs and the affairs of your family in a manner that would be pleasing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. يَنْبَغِي بِذَلِكْ رِضَى رَبِّهِ. Seeking, I want to look after you, I want to honor your position, I want to honor our kinship in a manner that God would be pleased with. And then he says, وَأَمِيرُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ مُشْتَاقٌ إِلَيْكَ. He says, I, Amir al-Mu'mineen, am longing to be with you. يُحِبُّ إِحْدَاثِ الْأَهْدِ بِكَ وَالنَّذَرِ إِلَيْكَ. And I would love to rekindle our relationship and to look at you. فَإِن نَشِتَّ لِزِيَارَتِهِ وَالْمُقَامِ قِبَلَهِ. He says, would you please hurry to visit me and reside with me if you so like? Very interesting how he places this question and he puts this question, right? We can see a couple of very interesting points and take a couple of very interesting lessons from this, right? The Imams were obviously well-versed with understanding that this was how politics work, right? You know, like maybe you and I would be deceived by that, in the sense that if I get a letter from someone who I know has a reputation of being bad, but yet I get a letter sweet-talking me, I might be convinced. I mean, we do that every election season, right? That we know the track records of our politicians, yet when they sweet talk us and when they target specific demographics, we fall for their charm. The Imam alayhi salam knew the intentions of Mutawakkil, and so even though this was a sweet talking by Mutawakkil, he knew the true intentions. And in many instances such as this, the Imam knew that they had no choice, right? So this was the first leg of sweet talking, which the Imam alayhi salam knew eventually would lead to a harsh reaction. And so the Imam considered this not really an invitation, rather a form of a summoning from Mutawakkil to Samarra. But I think the lesson that we have to take from this, right, is that we have to be very careful about not falling victim to news that we receive just because it sounds a certain way. You know, today we live in a day and age of fake news, right? We can watch two news channels who will provide us opposing views about what should be done, and it leaves a person very confused, you know. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He discusses this in the Holy Quran, right? The verse that I read in the khutbah from Surah 49, verse number 6, Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala says, Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu, that O you who believe, in ja'akum fasikum binaba'in fatabayyanu, that when an evildoer, someone who does not hold the same values as you, someone who is corruptive, comes at you with a report, look carefully into it. Don't just accept everything that you see. Don't just consider everything that you hear to be true. Rather, we have to be more perceptive, right? And realize that there are people in this world, unfortunately, who don't have our same interests, and they are governed by their own agendas, and we have to be able to decipher that. You know, sometimes it could be as simple as WhatsApp forwards, right? I mean, subhanAllah, like how many things float around out there. I mean, the cure of corona was sent by WhatsApp 6 months ago, right? But the fact is that in people just write something, send it, someone gets it, they don't take the time to look to see, Baba, is this true? Is there any validity into this? And you know what? Not everyone has the capacity to do so. But if you don't have the capacity to validate if something is true or not, then don't forward it, right? It's your responsibility to not forward it. And if you have then the ability to look at it and investigate it, you will find that a lot of times what is being said is not true, right? And then sometimes it behooves us as well to ask those who are experts. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as well mentions in the Quran, فَاسْأَلُوا أَهْلَ الذِّكْرِ إِن كُنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ, that if you don't know, then ask the people who do know. Ask the people of reminder. Go towards the right source. You get a hadith, the quotation is missing, the reference is missing. Don't just forward it, ask someone, right? But this is more true, especially when we live in this day and age of political wayfaring, really, where there are people whose main interest is to make sure that they come into power. And so we as people who are going to be the subjects of that power have a responsibility to fact check what is being said. And I think that that's a really interesting lesson that we can get from this, because look at how sweet Mutawakkil spoke to the Imam, right? And if it was me, I would be like, oh, Mutawakkil really wants to be with me, right? But the Imam was obviously savvy, he was smart, he had wisdom. And so we need to learn that wisdom from the Imam alayhi salam and understand how to handle such situations. Sallu ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. Allahumma salli ala Muhammadin wa Ali Muhammad. But also, like, another thing that's interesting about this is that you can tell the tone of Mutawakkil, in the sense that in this one letter, he calls himself Amir al-Mu'mineen 8 times, right? as if to say that no, not you are not Amir al-Mu'mineen. You are not really the leader of the people. You are not really the imam that Allah has chosen. Rather, it is me who is that leader. And so you can see how he could not stop his desires or his passion from driving his agenda. But again, this is how the Imam alayhi salam was quote unquote invited from Medina to Samarra, and that's when he leaves Medina with his family, and this is when they migrate. The 11th Imam is very young at this time, then they migrate towards Samarra. Now, the invitation came very much with happiness and glory, but as soon as the Imam alayhi salam reaches Samarra, the true colors of Mutawakkil are seen, and immediately the Imam alayhi salam is placed in an absolute slum with his family, constantly surrounded by military and guards. But of course, this was not something that was upsetting, but it showed the true nature of Mutawakkil and how what he really intended all along. Mutawakkil, not only was he trying to humiliate the Imam, but he was trying to have the Imam's reputation discredited. And so he would try time and time again to put the Imam in very difficult circumstances and situations, hoping that it would harm the reputation of the Imam alayhi salam. And there's one incident in particular that I'd like to mention. That once it is said in this tradition that Anna Mutawakkil qila lahu inna abal hasan, yani Ali ibn Muhammad bin Ali al-Ridha, that Mutawakkil was told that our 10th Imam alayhi salam yufassiru qawlallahi azza wa jal, that he understands and explains the following verse of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The verse is وَيَوْمَ يَعُضُّ الظَّالِمُ عَلَى يَدَيْهِ, and the day when the wrongdoer will bite his hand. He will bite his hand, why? Because he has regret. It is a sign of regret. يَقُولُ يَا لَيْتَنِ اتَّخَذْتُ مَعَ الرَّسُولِ سَبِيلًا يَا وَيْلَتَ لَمْ أَتَّخِذْ فُلَانًا خَلِيلًا, that his regret will be that I wish I had followed the Prophet's way. I wish I had not taken so and so as my friend. Mutawakkil was told that the 10th Imam understands or explains, yufassiru, does tafsir of this verse by saying that it is referring to the first two caliphs. That it's referring to one of them will say to Allah that I wish I hadn't followed him. And so he says to his people, what do you want me to do about this? And he said, they say to him, قَالُوا تَجْمَعُ لَهُ النَّاسِ, he said, call people together. وَتَسْأَلُهُ بِحَضْرَتِهِمْ, and ask him to explain these verses in front of everyone. And in this gathering, he said, would be his Shia and the Sunnah, and all of them will be together. So Mutawakkil wanted the Imam to be humiliated or create animosity amongst the Shia, because he felt the Imam had these two choices. Either he explains it the way he really intends for it, which would then alienate and bring about anger amongst the Sunnah, or the Imam, out of fear of angering this large crowd, would explain it differently, thus losing his own people. And so he was going to put the Imam between a rock and a hard place, you understand, right? And so he gathers all of these people together and he asks the Imam this question, right? He says that, explain these verses, that who are these two people, the one who will have a regret that he shouldn't have followed this other person. And the Imam alayhi salam replies back in this way, and he says, Hadan rajulan kunniya anhuma wa munna bisitri alayhima. He says, these two people who are being described in this verse have, out of the grace of Allah, been hidden. Their reputation has been hidden, and this is a favor that Allah has done for these two people. أَفَيُحِبُّ أَمِيرُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ أَنْ يَكْشِفَ مَا سَتَرَهُ اللَّهُ. He says, does the Amir al-Mu'mineen wish to reveal that which God Himself has hidden? Subhanallah, subhanallah. To which Mutawakkil replies, La, la uhibbu. Then no, I don't want to do that. Because Allah out of His grace has hidden it. Who are we to expose it? Sallu ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. Allahumma salli ala Muhammadin wa Ali Muhammad. We'll end with one more incident. We'll try to keep it within the time frame of 30 minutes, inshaAllah. Another incident was that once Mutawakkil imprisoned the Imam alayhi salam, and of course this was the tendency of Mutawakkil to try to inflict as much harm as possible. And so one of these incidents, when he imprisons the Imam alayhi salam, the Imam replies and says, or the Imam says out loud, Ana akramu ala Allahi min naqati salih. He said, I am more honored in the eyes of Allah than the camel, the she-camel of Salih. And then he recited the verse that Nabi Salih recited to his people. Tamatta'u fi darikum thalathata ayyamin. He says that enjoy yourselves in your homes for 3 days. Wa'adu ghayru makzub. This is a promise of Allah that will not be lied. It is not a lie. He just said that the very next day Mutawakkil released the Imam from prison. And he apologized. Maybe he was out of his drunken stupor, or he was regret, whatever it is. But then the history tells us, historians tell us, that on the third day, Turkish soldiers attacked Mutawakkil and killed him, fulfilling the promise of the one who is more honorable than the she-camel of Saleh. Sallu ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. These are just some very beautiful incidents. I thought that we should be familiar with, appreciate the position of the Imam, and of course learn from him. You know, the Imam alayhi salam was exiled, humiliated, imprisoned, put in the worst of situations physically. Yet the Imam never lost his akhlaq. The Imam alayhi salam never lost his faith. And no matter what you and I go through in our lives, it's important we never lose our faith and we never lose our akhlaq in dealing with people. We pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He hastens the return of our Imam, that He forgives the sins of our parents and loved ones, for those going through difficulty, that He end their difficulty, for those that have asked us to pray for them, Ya Allah, accept their hajat. Rabbana taqabbal minna innaka anta as-sami'ul alim. Walhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. رحم الله من قرأ سورة المباركة الفاتحة تسبقها الصلاة على محمد وآل محمد